Good morning and welcome to Bethany this beautiful Sunday morning. We're so glad you're here today. We wish to convey our deepest sympathy to the family of John Griffin. His funeral was held here yesterday, and as people of faith, we know that John and Phyllis are now together for eternal life, and what a blessing that is. A very special thank you to Becky Caldwell and the volunteers for coordinating Bible school this week. There was a small group, but that didn't dim the enthusiasm. Please take a moment to look at the Vacation Bible School mural on the windows in the back of the sanctuary. There's a gospel music concert by the Ball Brothers next Sunday at the Methodist Church at 9 a.m. and at 2 p.m., and the community has been invited to attend. Please see your bulletin for more information. A reminder to 2021 Council and committee members that next Sunday is installation day, so please plan to attend. We will also be hosting an outdoor thank you gathering following worship for Assistant Bishop Libby Howell. The Hospitality Committee will be serving treats, and we will take a moment to wish Pastor Libby all the best in her next call. The Stewardship Committee is seeking volunteers to assist with preparing, serving, and delivering meals for the August 29th drive-through community cookout. Please let the office know if you are willing to lend a hand. Today, we are blessed to have one of Bethany's previous interim pastors with us. Please help welcoming Pastor Kris, Fahey. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for such a warm welcome. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
Great. Thank you. Thanks for the feedback. The announcements have already been made, other than the fact that I'm very happy to be here, and it brings back a lot of really good memories of Bethany. I'd like to invite you all now to rise. And we will begin with the call to worship. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the God of manna, the God of miracles, and the God of mercy.
Amen.
Drawn to Christ and seeking God's abundance, let us confess our sin. God, our provider.
Help us.
It is hard to believe there is enough to share. We question your ways when they differ from the ways of the world we live. We turn to our own understanding rather than trusting in you. We take offense at your teachings and your ways. Turn us again to you, or else can you turn. Share with us the rivers of eternal life, and feed us our lives in the world. Amen.
Beloved people of God, in Jesus, the manna from heaven, you are fed and nourished. By Jesus, the worker of miracles, there is always more than enough. Through Jesus, the bread of life, you are shown God's mercy. You are forgiven and loved into abundant life.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, eternal goodness, immeasurable love, you place your gifts before us. We eat and are satisfied. Fill us and this world in all its need with the life that comes only from you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Let us sing the opening hymn.
Thank you.
Exodus chapter 16. The whole congregation of Israelites complained against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat it by the flesh pots and ate our fill of bread. For you have brought us out into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger." Then the Lord said to Moses, "I am going to rain bread from heaven for you, and each day the people shall go out and gather enough for that day. In that way I will test them, whether they will follow my instructions or not." Then Moses said to Aaron, "Say to the whole congregation of Israelites, 'Draw near to the Lord, for he has heard your complaining.'" And as Aaron spoke to the whole congregation of the Israelites, they looked toward the wilderness, and the glory of the Lord appeared in a cloud. The Lord spoke to Moses and said, "I have heard the complaining of the Israelites. Say to them, 'At twilight you shall eat meat, and in the morning you shall have your fill of the bread. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God.' In the evening the quails came up and covered the camp, and in the morning there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the layer of dew lifted, there on the surface of the wilderness was a fine, flaky substance, as fine as frost on the ground. When the Israelites saw it, they said to one another, 'What is it?' For they did not know what it was. Moses said to them, 'It is the bread of that the Lord has given you to eat.'" The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 78 is the second longest psalm in the Old Testament. It's a long one. And it's a hodgepodge of memories, snippets of history, of God's covenant. There's a back and forth here about how wonderful God has been. And then as the people of God, how much we have forgotten to follow. How great God has been to bring us back, and how we have sort of always gone our own way and neglected to understand. And then how graceful, and you understand? Yeah, this particular section of Psalm 78 goes with the Old Testament story, the people in the desert being fed by God's manna and quail. Out of nowhere, manna. The word for manna is man. Try that. Man, that's in Hebrew. And it means what? It's in, what is this? What is this stuff? This manna? We don't even know what it is, but I guess we can eat it. The stuff that would go bad in a day, so you couldn't store it. You just needed to trust that maybe tomorrow it'll be there too. The song for today is called What? I think this passage in the Psalms might invite us to think about what is it that we need right now? What does the world need to be fulfilled? It goes like this. Listen. What will satisfy our longing? What will make our hunger rest? Open the hearts, welcome the wind. For what will fulfill this ache in us? Try that with me very softly. Satisfy our longing. What will
I therefore, the prisoner in the Lord, beg you to lead a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called. With all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is only one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and all in all. But each of us is given grace according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore it is said, when he ascended on high, he made the captivity itself a captive. He gave gifts to his people. When it says he ascended, what does it mean that he had also descended into the lower parts of the earth? He who descended is the same one who ascended far above all of the heavens, so that he might fill all things. The gifts he gave were that some would be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, to equip the saints for the work of the ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until all of us come to unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to maturity, to the measure of the full stature of Christ. We must no longer be children tossed to and fro and blown about by every wind of doctrine, by people's trickery, by their craftiness and deceitful scheming, but speaking the truth in love. We must grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knitted together by every ligament with which it is equipped, and each part is working properly, promotes the body, its growth, and building itself up in love. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God. I invite you to rise as you are able. The Holy Gospel according to St. John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When the crowd saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were beside the sea, they themselves got into the boats and went to Capernaum looking for Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly I tell you, you are looking for me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal." Then they said to him, "What must we do to perform the works of God?" Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." So they said to him, "What sign are you going to give us then, so that we may see it and believe in you? What work are you performing? Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat." Then Jesus said to them, "Very truly, I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, But it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. They said to him, Sir, give us this bread always. Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. One of the first questions people ask when they want to get to know someone is this: what do you do for a living? You know, our culture does have a very strong work ethic, and that means that we're often evaluated by how much we accomplish, how hard we work, how good our performance was. This must be part of our DNA as human beings, and it must be the result of many, many years over time where human beings have always had to work to get a crumb or a crust of bread. And work is kind of a carrot on a stick. Getting paid either in the pride that we have after we did a good job, or by accomplishments we've achieved, causes us to work even harder. If you're watching the Olympics right now, the power of what people can do when they work harder and harder and practice more and more at what their sport is really quite amazing, that our bodies can go through all of those kinds of physical athletic feats. I think about especially the people that are doing the balancing beam and things like that. Some of us might work towards similar achievements in the challenges that we each have. We may not be in the Olympics, but in our lives we have challenges, and instead of just, you know, ignoring them or turning away, we work hard at them in order to achieve something and get healthier or get better or do our job better or be a better family member. All of those things we work at. All of us. All of us. Whether we are athletes, employers, employees, supervisors, students, teachers, all of us who are Christians, wishing to follow our Lord, experience the rigors of hard work sometimes, and the rigors, the greater rigors, of people always evaluating us. We know by the criticisms that we have, we need good news. And in the Gospel of John today, we hear of something that Christ is giving to everyone. It is something that is not based on how perfectly we accomplish our works or how well we keep the laws or how well we do anything. It's so unlike all the other things in our lives where we are always being evaluated. But we have something here that is not just another evaluation. That was done in the Ten Commandments, of course. But now we have something that is good news from God. It's the gospel. We worry about, we worry about wealth and having enough, and especially doing well enough. But we do not love one another as much as we ought to, because we're so busy worrying and thinking about all of the things that we're called to do.
And here in this gospel, Christ comforts me. Christ says, do not work for the food that perishes, but instead work for the food that endures, that lasts, that continues, not only throughout our lives, but into eternal life. And this food the Son of Man gives to you and will give to you more and more. So we learn in today's gospel that the work of Christ speaks to us, and the work of Christ speaks more to our faith, our believing, our trusting, our receiving what Christ says to us, than it speaks to how well we do our works or how many works we do. It's this faith that just comes to us through the Holy Spirit, through the word of Christ, and it comes to each of you, and it will continue to come to you throughout your lives. And then at the end of your life, the big good news will come for you, the resurrection of the body and the life in the kingdom of heaven. Work is hard and strenuous, as I said before, but a gift is easy. And it's not a payment for something. You know, it's not like an equal exchange where you get this payment that's at the same level of the amount of work that you deserved, or that you get because you deserved it, or that you did. Today's entire gospel is about something that is just given to you. And so, the way that you get the gospel is kind of like this. It's like Jesus throwing it out to you and saying, here, catch. And it's an easy catch, something that you can just wrap your hands around, as Luther said. And then you have it. Only you have it in your heart and in your whole way of being. And you have it as something that's not what you normally would think. It's sort of like an alien righteousness. It comes from another source. It doesn't come from all of your good works and how well you measure up. It comes from Jesus. And it's like he throws it out and says, catch, this is for you. And it's an easy catch, not a hard one. It doesn't just fall through our hands. So this is what the gospel is. Something we cannot do, but we have to receive. The crowd listening to Jesus thought, what do I have to do in order to perform the works of God? But they already had the answer. They didn't have to ask Jesus that. Moses had already given it to them. He said, follow the commandments. Love God. Read the Bible. Worship God. But these are things that we don't have to do. They're things we get to do, because we have Christ in our hearts. And anybody who's ever attended a really good welcome Bible study, you know, after you've gone through that, or another men's Bible study in church, or a confirmation even, you know that somewhere in all of that, you hear good news. So this following the commandments and loving God and reading the Bible and worshiping God does produce things. That's what we all do here together. And these acts really are above all of the other acts we do in life. Because we do these other acts that we have to do, or that we like to do, but these are the pinnacle. They're at the top. So, in other words, reading the Bible, keeping the commandments, worshiping God, are also ways that we grow in faith. And the result is also a gift for us, because we know that God is with us. And we know that God is present with us, even in our difficulty. And it's something outside of us. And we know that God always gives good gifts. God gives good gifts. But God is, beyond the gifts that God gives, we have this special gift, and that is grace. You know, it's not another law, it's not another commandment. It's different. It's the gospel. The commandments are for us.
But this commandment to love one another is one that Jesus helps us to do through the cross and the resurrection. So imagine when the disciples were at the Last Supper. And then after that, he went to the Garden of Gethsemane to pray. And he said to his followers, "Stay awake with me and pray with me." But they could not resist falling asleep. And so the fact that that's true about all of us, we can't just measure up completely to what we're asked to do. We fall under this judgment. Because, you know, these disciples here, they were supposed to stay awake, so they were naturally under the judgment. But picture this, Christ was sitting there with them, physically with them, back in the first century. And Christ is with us, spiritually, and with his word, and with this church gathered together. And when we leave from this church and go home, Christ is with you. And for us, in his word, in all of these things, in his prayer, in the prayers that we make, in the Holy Spirit, in the Holy Communion that we celebrate, he absolves all sins. All sins are forgiven. There is not a sin that you can do that will not be forgiven. So this gospel is pure gift. Christ is this gift, and he's already done the deadly work of dying on the cross. And God has already done holy of raising him up. And God has given us the Holy Spirit and the church together and the sacraments. We can't earn any of this. All we can do is just receive it and be happy and know that it's good news. And not only that, when we go out from here, it's good news in all of the vicissitudes, the troubles, the frustrations, things that don't go our way in life. Whatever those things are, they're always out there. God gives you the good news. It's sort of like God giving you this good news, like throwing a treat out if you're like a little doggy, and the dog just jumping up and grabbing it. And that's what the church is like. You know, God is throwing this blessing out, this gift, this good news. And we're wrapping our hands around. And to just sum it up, it's this. The good news is Christ, the forgiveness of sins through Christ, and the new life that we already have in this world, and the life forever in the world yet to come. It's for you, and it's for everyone. It's something. It's the bread in the wilderness. It's the word that brings eternal life. It's something God is doing.
Jesus. Amen.
Through
grace we
do.
I invite you to stand as you are able for the prayers of the people. And the petitions will end with me saying, "Hear us, O God," and you say, "Your mercy is great." You call your church to be the body of Christ. Awaken all the baptized to the gifts you provide for carrying out the work of ministry. And the gifts are many here. Where the church is divided, knit us together and restore the unity of the faith among all people. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You summon leaders to respond to the needs of your people. Instill those who govern with patience when confronted with grievances, and perseverance in seeking and what promotes the well-being of our communities. We especially think about the time of change that we're in, where people of different races and different groups are able to more hear each other and live together. We thank you for that. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You draw near to those who cry out for help. Feed those who are hungry. Reassure those who are despairing. And accompany those who are imprisoned. Rain down the true bread from heaven that gives life to the world. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You receive all who come seeking a sign of grace. Make this congregation at Bethany a place of hospitality for those who are accustomed to rejection. Bless those ministries among us where we do those things. And to those who have felt excluded here or elsewhere, prepare us to welcome them in the name of Christ. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You heal us, O Lord, in your mercy. And so you invite us to pray for healing. And we ask for healing today, that you may bring healing to Marcus Brown, Wayne Morris, Ron Engold, Cam Gertz, the Dillon family, Emil and Cheryl Skorik. And we pray that you would provide also comfort in the food that endures for eternal life and that promise. For the families of Janet Field, of Lyman, Jimmy Hoylan, Marcella Schrader, John Griffin, Louis Bowles, and Larry Bowles. And to these prayers, we also add any prayers of our home, of those we know outside of this community. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
You provide food that endures for eternal life. Sustain us each day with the bread of life that we are gathered with, until we are gathered with all the saints and feast together in your heavenly banquet. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We lift these in all our prayers to you, O God, confident in the promise of your saving love through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
There's a box in the back where they can put their offering.
Great. So you, as you leave, you can put your offering in the box in the back. Gather what has been sown among us and strengthen us in the meal. Make us to be what we receive here, your body for the life of the world. Amen.
I invite you to stand as you are able. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
And it is right to give our thanks and praise.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let us pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
And now, as we all commune ourselves, I invite everyone to receive the bread and the juice. The body of Christ given for you. Body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. Jesus, bread of life, we have received from your table more than we could ever ask. As you have nourished us in this meal, now strengthen us to love the world with your own life. In your name we pray.
Song is blessed be the tide of times. Please be good to divine, for our
please stand. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen. Go in peace. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please notice the announcements that are in your bulletin. There's a council installation coming up. And that will be Sunday, August 8th at the 9:30 service. All the council members for 2021 will be installed. And then assistant to the bishop, Libby Howe, will be here leading our worship that day. And she's very excited to come and do this installation. So please plan to attend the service in support of this meaningful event. And then also, the Mauston United Methodist Church is bringing the Ball Brothers, a Christian quartet from Chattanooga, Georgia, here on Sunday, August 8th. They will do a worship service at 9 a.m. and then a community outreach concert at 2 o'clock p.m. And you don't need a ticket, just a free will offering. And then just thank you for being such wonderful hosts for me and for my husband, Tom, Fahey, over there. And it's just really fun to be at Bethany again. And just great to see you all. Go in peace.